Hello everybody, my name is Walter, and today I want to show you how you can build three rather simple drowning traps. The first two are a room that, once triggered, fills completely with water. And the third is a version where you have an already flooded room with a conduit power running, and once you trigger it, the conduit power runs out. And with that said, let's show those three in actions. So let's start with the first one, which is just a simple plain room, obviously with something eye-catching in the center, which you may want to remove, but if you do so, the entire thing triggers, the door closes, and as you can see, the whole thing gets flooded, and if there wasn't a conduit in the vicinity, I would now be drowning. And obviously there is no easy way around this, so let me quickly reset this entire stage here. And now let's look at the second version, which is not a simple plain room, but instead now we have a row of waterfalls around the walls. And again our trap trigger here, which once more, when triggered, closes the door. This time the walls retract, or those pillars retract for a moment, and everything gets flooded once more. Again, without a conduit in this vicinity, I would quickly start to drown and die. And with that, let's quickly get to the third version, which is basically a version that works for an underwater base or similar. So, as you can see, at the moment I have conduit power running and no big issue, but once I trigger the entire system, again the door closes. And as you can see here, the conduit power starts to run out. And if I don't get out of here quickly enough, well, I will start drowning. Although I must admit, it is quite easy to get out of this once you have removed the trigger block by digging through the slime blocks, which means that this setup here is only really usable when you're using it as part of an adventure map where you can actually make sure that the player is not actually capable of removing certain blocks, or can only remove the trapped blocks themselves. Anyway, that is what these things here are for. Now let's talk about the sizes. Obviously, the overall size is determined by the size of the room you want to trap. The room, by the way, must be rectangular. There are also a few more requirements to keep in mind, but I will talk about them more when we're building that. Anyway, additionally to the size of the room, you need to either side three blocks, as well as to the back three additional blocks, and five blocks towards the bottom, which here are just for the part that closes the door, the part which is the actual trigger, and the connection between the trigger and the walls. For the conduit version, the actual layout of the room itself doesn't matter at all, because all you need is a completely flooded room and a conduit below the floor. So you have once more five blocks down, the part where the door closes, the trigger, and then a toggleable conduit, which is just a conduit and a sticky piston. And that's the entire layout and sizes. And with that, it's time to talk about the required resources. So for my trigger and door mechanism, you're gonna need a couple building blocks, then four stairs, which are part of this pillar here, then a single obsidian block, six slime blocks, the block you want to use to trigger the entire thing, in this case I'm using a diamond block, then a redstone block, 11 redstone dust, three redstone repeaters, three comparators, a single observer, a sticky piston, six normal pistons, and two hoppers. For the conduit trap, it's a single redstone dust, a sticky piston, the conduit, and the prismarine to activate the conduit. Then for the two wall versions, you're gonna need, for the connection between trigger and walls, an observer, 12 redstone dust, and 3 redstone torches. Depending on which version you build, you may be left with a few of those, but that is the overall necessary resources. And for the walls themselves, you're gonna need a few slabs, quite a few stairs, a lot of redstone dust and sticky pistons, and a few redstone repeaters. The overall number is once more depending on the overall size of the room. But as a rule of thumb, all you need to do is take the surface area of the visible and trapped walls, so the walls that are actually moving, divide it by two, and you have a rough estimate of how many pistons and how many redstone dust you need. And additionally to that, you're gonna need a handful of redstone wire and a few repeaters to interconnect the various sites. And that's pretty much all you're gonna need, and that means it's time to show you how to build those traps here. Okay, so the first step is figuring out the layout of your trapped room. For the conduit trap version, that is not really an issue, since all you need is a flooded base, without any requirements concerning the layout. But for the two versions that you're using moving walls, you're gonna need to make sure that the entire thing fulfills a few requirements. The first is that you need at least two adjacent walls that are trapped. If you're going for a symmetrical setup, I would actually recommend going with three walls being trapped. Then, as you can see, I've already marked with gold the places where the parts of the wall are being moved later on by the pistons. As you can see, the middle wall, if you have three trapped walls, must be an odd number of blocks wide in that case. The width of the other two is pretty much up to you. The only real requirement is that the entire thing here is a rectangle in some way. Next up we have a door. I'm going with a 3 wide 2 high doorway. You can adjust this as you want. And you need an area where the trigger will be placed. I would recommend having it so far away from the entrance that you are not able to actually trigger the entire thing while you're outside of this trap here. So you must get in here before you can actually trigger the entire thing. So something between 5 and 7 blocks is a good distance there. The trigger itself needs a cross-shaped hole inside of the floor. And the wall version, where you have the waterfalls visible all the time, also requires to not spill the water everywhere, that you have in between the columns, or more precisely, in front of the gap between the columns, a waterlogged block with the waterlogged surface looking upwards. This is the main reason I'm having this little picture at the bottom here, those little water channels there. And that are pretty much all of the requirements, which means now it's time to start building the actual trigger. Now, obviously, you can use many kinds of triggers, but for the trigger I selected for this build, all you need to do is to start with a redstone block at the back of this cross-shaped hole, an observer at the front, then a slime block in the middle, one on top, then you can place your four stairs around, like so. Now the entire thing should close up, as you can see there. Then put your diamond block or whatever you want to have on top of that. Make sure this is a movable block. Then let's go down. Go down with three more slime blocks. Then towards the direction with the redstone block, another slime block. And then a sticky piston facing downwards right there. Next, we need a obsidian block next to the slime block in this corner here. Then a comparator up on top of this obsidian block. Now place down two hoppers facing each other and put a single item inside of that. And now, if we remove the diamond block in this case, you will see that everything gets retracted downwards, and now the trap would be triggered. To reset the entire thing, just remove the redstone block, replace the trap block there, and then replace the redstone block again. So that's the trigger done. And then let's go down here. And we start with a block in front of the hopper here. Then let's grab a few more blocks. And let's start with a repeat on vortex, taking output from this observer here when the entire thing gets triggered. Then place a simple 2x3 of blocks there, a comparator here and here. Connect them on both sides with redstone wire. Then go down a layer here, place another repeater on one tick there. Run this into a full block, then blocks to either side. Then with a high gap, another 3 blocks down here, put down 3 redstone dust on top of those double layers. Grab normal pistons and place them like so. So again a 2x3. And then let's place a double row of blocks on top of that. That is basically the door part done. So if we now trigger the entire thing, you should see the door now closes. And the last part is then filling in the walls so that the entire thing will get flushed. But let's quickly reset the entire thing down here. So one quick insert here. Apparently due to a position-dependent piston bug, this type of door has some issues. But there is a rather simple fix which will work all the time. Just move this block up by one, put a repeater on 2 ticks. Then place down a block here, another block diagonal to that, some redstone wire there, and a repeater on 1 tick there. And now the door should close independent of where you actually build it. And voila, so now everything is reset. And I also copied the entire layout 2 more times, so we now have one setup for each trap type. Anyway, next step is to build the 2 wall trap versions. And both start pretty much the same way. So first you need to figure out which parts of the walls are actually moving. For that you have an alternating setup between moving and non-moving parts of the wall. And what is important here is if you have adjacent trapped walls, then the corner block is next to non-moving segment of the wall. That's really important for the entire thing to work. And also the reason why if you have a 3 wall setup like here, this middle wall here must be an odd number of blocks wide. Anyway, the next step is placing some columns of sticky pistons right behind the future walls essentially. And once you have done that, you can connect them using rows of blocks with redstone wire behind them. One row of blocks powers 2 sticky pistons. And that is a modular design you can basically add on top of as high as you need to go. And that you need to do for all trapped walls, for both wall trap versions. And this here should be the end result of that. So now I have all 3 walls with the pistons, the lines behind the pistons, and I also interconnected those lines already, so that I only need to power this redstone line here at the bottom. And via those repeaters here, I'm now powering also the 2 lines on the sides. And via the redstone split here using the upside down snaps, I'm also powering the top pistons here. If your room is higher than just 4 blocks, then you will need to add another layer of pistons and blocks and interconnect them. If the lines are too long for whatever reason, you may have to put in some additional repeaters here to make sure that when you power this line at the back here, everything gets powered. So from this point on, the 2 versions deviate a bit. So let's start with the version with the flat walls. For that, first you go down to this redstone line here and elongate it until you reach this point at the back here. Put redstone wire on top. Like so. Then run this into a block with a torch on the side of it, block on top, block to the side of it, and now you should have a 1 high gap between the torch and this block with the redstone wire. And here you place an observer on top of the torch, facing upwards and looking at the torch. One thing I should mention here is that the whole thing here will not completely fill up with water if the room is too high. The reason is pretty simple. The water needs some time to build up the individual layers. And if the parts of the wall retract again before the entire thing has reached the ceiling, obviously the whole thing will not fill up completely. If that is the case, you can double the time of this pulse extender by simply replacing this redstone wire between the repeater and the comparator by a full block. Then you have basically just doubled the delay in the system here. If that is still not enough, then you may have to change up the system down here a bit and may have to include a loop with 3 or 4 comparators in total. But for normal users, this should be quite enough. Now for the waterfall version, there are actually 2 ways you can set this up. The first I will show you is the way you have seen it working in the introduction of this video. And that is the pillars first retracting and then after some time extending again. This once more only works if the room is small enough. This time it's not the height of the entire room that's limiting the system, but it's more of the surface area of the floor which is limiting the system a bit, because the water spreading once more stops as soon as the pillars come out again. Again, if the delay is not enough, you can simply replace this redstone wire here with a full block. Now for this setup, all you need to do is simply take the system signal from this wire here, invert it, and then run it along a line of redstone wire all the way to the front here, followed by 2 blocks going diagonally, which should end up with a 1-high gap below this line, with the redstone wire on top. Then torch, another torch, and a line of redstone wire over here, which should connect everything here up, like this. And that's the first setup. The second setup only retracts the pillars when the entire thing gets triggered and doesn't extend them anymore. This system is pretty simple. All you need to do is place a block here. Sorry, here. Place some redstone dust on top. Then place a full block here with a torch on the side of it. And then simply run the line of redstone around those. You basically don't need this part at the back there. So let me quickly remove that again. And the rest is as before, so basically a double inversion to get the signal up here. And with that, the room can be as big as you want, and it will still flood completely. And that's the circuitry pretty much finished, which means now it's time to start filling in the walls. So for the walls, let's start with the flat version here. The first step is actually placing blocks next to the pistons. I will do this only for the lowest layer, since the other layers are just a copy of that. Anyway, the first step is placing blocks next to those pistons. I will just do this on this side for now. The rest you will see after I cut. But once you have built one side, it's time to take your stairs and place them on the edges of each side, sideways. And then in between, with the back side facing the room, and come on, the last one, like so. And once you have done that, you can waterlock all those stairs here. Obviously, you can also do some pixel art using different types of stairs, but I will leave it with completely blank and flat walls here. Anyway, this is just one wall, one layer of that, and you have to do this a few more times until you reach the top of your room. And this here is the end result of that. Now let's go and let's do a similar thing for the waterfall version here. The first step is to actually place blocks in between the extended piston arms. And since those blocks will be visible, I would recommend using something that looks not as ugly as any kind of block. Then, of course, you need to do this all around. And then you need to place again a column of blocks in front of the piston arms. once more all around the room, and then fill in those gaps between the pillars with water sources. Make sure you fill it completely from the very bottom to the very top and have no flowing water in between there. One thing I need to mention here is that you should be careful that you don't forget to fill in those somewhat hidden corners here. They also need to be filled with water. Again, from the very bottom to the very top. And voila, so now all the walls are finished, which means now it's time to fill in the ceiling. Here, just make sure that there are no air pockets once the entire thing here gets flooded, or otherwise the whole thing will not work as it should, obviously. And voila, so as you can see, now I have filled in a ceiling, which is basically just a mirror image of the floor, which has no area where actually a player could fit his or her head into, so there is no problem with drowning them. I also added a bit of light in the floor to make sure that nothing can spawn in here, which is not really an issue for this version, but more one for this version here with the flat surface on the edges. And well, basically that's those two versions done, which means now it's time to start with the conduit trap. Okay, so for the conduit-based trap, we need some kind of trigger, which will produce a constant signal once the whole thing was triggered. In this case here, we can simply place a block here, put some redstone dust on top, and then take a sticky piston as our mechanical component. And that's basically all of the redstone circuitry necessary for this trap. After that, build a 5x5 ring out of prismarine or a similar block which will activate a conduit, then place a conduit in the center of it. Next, we need to make sure that we have our 3x3 cube in the center that we can fill with water. So make sure that you get this outer cage all the way around. So, those corners actually are not necessary here. Then fill in the bottom. Obviously you are not forced to use glass here. Then fill in the entire thing with water. And with that done, we are finished. And with that, the last part in this situation here is filling in the walls, put in a ceiling, and then filling the entire thing with water. Since I don't want to have any water spilling over, I have also this outer edge of waterlogged blocks here, which is the only reason I have put them there. And how this looks, you will see after the cut. And voila, so now everything is finished up. My conduit power is currently running, and with that, everything is waiting for the next player to come and trigger this trap here. And with that, we have finally reached the end of this tutorial about those three simple drowning traps. I hope you enjoyed this little tutorial, and well, see ya!